An introduction to interpretable machine learning. So just in case you need some links on the slide for later reference, you can have the links to the slides. And how many of you are here with are familiar with Google Colab? So basically I have some code later which is a hands-on demo, so there's the link to the Colab notebook. You can just open it and just sign in with a Google account and sign in with playground mode to get the code running. So we'll come to that later. Just in case you need them, you can have a photograph so that we can move forward. So just before starting, a little bit about myself. So I'm a self-taught web developer and data scientist. Started off with web development, eventually moved to data science. And I love working at startups. That teaches us so much because there are a lot of things that you have to do by yourself. And I worked at one of the best healthcare startups in the Silicon Valley in the past. And I'm still a student, so I'm currently in my final year of graduation. And if you want to reach out, here are the details. And yeah. So this is the agenda for today. We are going to go briefly over a data science life cycle, like what are the steps that you should take when working on a data science project. Joshua highlighted some of that. We are going to go through that again. Then we are going to go through why do we need our models to be more interpretable. Then I'm going to discuss some libraries that you can use to interpret your machine learning models, and in the end I'm going to give you some further resources which you can use to go in depth in this topic, and then finally we're going to see a hands-on example. So I plan to finish this in 30 minutes, and I will try to keep it more and more introductory and more from an applied point of view. So we are going to see some code because I don't want to go much into detail into the math, so that because that's going to get too much boring, and yeah, some code can hopefully make sense of it. So just again to recap on a data science project life cycle, like what are the steps that you usually go through? Yeah, sure. Yeah, I'll be going through a 10,000 feet overview. So like you get an understanding of the techniques that I'm discussing, because going into much detail into a math would take too much time. Yeah, so I have some references at the end. You can go, there are some research papers too which you can read, so you can get a fair enough idea if you want to get too much into math, because I don't think I have that much time. So I will give you an upper level intuition so that we can go with it. So basically the first step in any data science project would be to understand the business requirements of the client. So basically the first step here would be to define your problem clearly, understand the needs of your customer or your client, and to satisfy and check for any constraints, if there are any. Once you are thorough with the business requirements, you understand what is the project is all about, you go on data acquisition. Now there are again multiple ways in which you can acquire data, maybe through some ETL queries, maybe through some SQL, and your data might be in a database, log files, or in a Hadoop or Spark cluster. Now typically in a big organization, the first two steps or the data acquisition step is done by the data engineers. But if you're working at a startup, all of this has to be done by data scientists, because there are not a lot many people in the startup. So once you are with the data, the next step would be to prepare your data, to visualize it using some exploratory data analysis, and to do feature engineering. That's one of the most important steps in a machine learning pipeline. Once you are done with all of that, you clean it, you pre-process your data, you visualize it. Next step would be to build your machine learning model and set a KPI for your model. That is the key performance index on which you're going to test how well does your model do. And then the next step is model interpretation and result communication. Now this is what we'll be going in detail today. And it's very important to explain the results of your machine learning model to your stakeholders, whether they understand data science or not. And basically the next step would be, once you are done with the model building, interpreting your model, the next step would be to deploy the model. Again, there are many options. Joshua explained that in detail. You can deploy our model as a software as a service. You can use AWS, Google Cloud Platform, Docker. There are a lot of options available here. Once you are through with that, you should go for a real world testing of your software or your model, like how well does it do, and A/B testing is the thing that you want to do. And once you are done with all of that, the final step is the client buy-in, when the client or the customer is totally satisfied with what you have done and they want to go in. And then there are further operations like retraining the model frequently, or depending on how frequent you get the new data, and then improving your model, looking for any failures that are occurring and trying to fix them so that your code doesn't break in the production environment, and optimization of your code and all that stuff. So I talked about the data science lifecycle. Now the first question that comes to our mind when we talk about interpretability is, why do you need machine learning interpretability in the first place? So basically, let's say you are working on a data science project, you cleaned your data, you pre-processed it, you are done with the feature engineering, you generated some fancy features and you gave it to a model and it performed well. You selected the best model, you optimized your hyperparameters, everything is going fine, and all of a sudden your boss comes in and he says that okay, you have done a great job, you built a nice model and it works well on the testing data, but one of the key aspects here is to explain your model to your stakeholders, and even if they are not technical people, so you need to be able to explain like why your model is taking a certain decision in a very reason, like why are you charging that particular price to a client. And again, this is again another example in the finance domain where you are building a model to decide whether to lend a loan to a person or not. And basically you can again go through this, like the police and the crime department are also using machine learning to predict like who is more likely to commit a crime. So you cannot hold a person liable for a crime without giving an explanation just because a machine learning model told that he's about to make a crime. You cannot do that, like that's really important. And again, in e-commerce, where it's not more likely, it's important, but again, it's useful to understand like the trends and how you can make it better. And particularly if I talk about healthcare and finance, it becomes really important to interpret your models, because with the rise of data protection acts such as the GDPR, interpretation of your machine learning model becomes even more important. And further, if I talk about industries such as self-driving cars and healthcare, one inaccurate prediction can be quite costly. So you might wanna know like what your model is doing and interpret them to make it better. So a model is only as good as the data you feed it, so that's true. So your machine learning model will be what your data is. So a model will learn only what the data supplies it, and that includes any bias in the data. So it's basically a garbage in, garbage out thing. So if any of you here are familiar with NLP, so if I have to tell you that word2x is a little gender biased towards male just because of the text corpus that it was trained on. So that is something that comes with your model, like the data you feed it, it's gonna learn that. And again, this is from one of the research papers that I will reference later. So this was a model to predict the difference between wolf and huskies. And what this model does is, if you give it a picture of a husky, so it classified it as a wolf. And later when we used some techniques to try to explain that, so it was that the model, whenever it saw snow in the background, it was classifying it as a wolf. So rather than a husky or a wolf detector, we just built a snow detector here. So basically, you can see in the right image that it's really important to understand what your model is doing. So now let's talk about some of the models that we can use, or which are easily interpretable, or what we can call it as a white box models. So if you're familiar with the linear models, such as linear regression or logistic regression, or generalized linear model, so these generally come with a weight associated with each feature. So when they are making some sort of prediction, so you can get the weight value associated to a particular feature so that you can interpret, and these are highly interpretable models. Then if I talk about decision trees, these are again nested if else conditions, like the one on the right is an example of a decision tree. So if you're having a decision tree with a reasonable depth, it's again fairly easy to interpret them. And again, I would say that linear SVMs or SVMs are also interpretable to some extent if you're using a linear kernel and not a complicated kernel. SVMs too can be interpreted pretty easily. So not all models are easy to explain. Some are really complex and some are completely black box. So if you're familiar with ensemble models, like a combination of multiple models, we basically have bagging. A random forest is an example of that, and we have boosting. XGBoost might be an example of that. So these are a little harder to interpret, but usually they come with a feature importance. But the problem with that is, if I'm talking about random forest, so the feature importance would be the combined importance of all the decision trees that are being used to constitute the random forest. So basically, there are two problems here. So one, the feature importance that you're getting with random forest is not telling you how much, whether it's affecting your target positively or negatively. And again, another disadvantage here, or why you should not use and or why you should not rely too much on the feature importance, is that different libraries have different implementations. So like if I have to talk about XGBoost or any boosting algorithm, the feature importance will be calculated differently amongst different libraries. So we need a standard procedure. Like, so does it always mean that you should use simple models? So in machine learning or in the data science field, you generally have this accuracy versus interpretability trade-off. The more accurate your model is, the less interpretable it's going to be. And the more interpretable it is, the less accurate it's going to be. Of course, there are some exceptions, but generally this is how the trend works. So basically, when I talk about ensemble models, going one step further, if you're familiar with artificial neural nets, so like they are complete black box. And we all might be knowing that here the neural nets are quite popular for great accuracy that they are building. But again, they are very less interpretable, and in fields like healthcare, as I mentioned, interpretability plays quite an important role. So you just not might be wanting your model to be entire black box, and you might want to go and interpret it. Okay, so these are some of the libraries that you can use. Due to time constraints, I'm going to talk about ELI5 and LIME. So ELI5 is basically explained like M5. If you are familiar with Reddit, so there are a lot of subreddits like in general which are ELI5. So the concept is to explain a concept very simply and in a very brief manner, so that a five-year kid can understand what you're trying to explain very easily. And the second technique that we are going to talk about is LIME. So that's basically local interpretable model agnostic explanations. I will come to LIME in a second and ELI5. And these are some other libraries that you can use. So SHAP is again one of the methods that you can use, that's shapely additive explanations. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go into detail. And then Yellow Bricks and MLXtrain, and there are many more lists of a lot of libraries that you can use. So you can go to this link later if you want to have a look. So basically, talking about ELI5, so ELI5 is really good for the interpretation of white box models, as I mentioned in earlier slides, and it integrates very well with scikit-learn models. So if you're using scikit-learn to build your machine learning models, ELI5 might want to be your choice to interpret your models. And again, it can be used to provide both global explanations and local explanations. So what I mean by global explanation is trying to visualize how your model behaves on a global view. So if I'm using a decision tree, so a global explanation would mean that I'm trying to get the feature importances on a global level and based on all the observations. Whereas a local explanation would be, if I'm trying to explain a particular data point or a particular observation, like why is it assigning it this class label, so that would be local explanation. And how ELI5 works is it tries to look the model internally, see how it works, and gives the result. So for example, if I'm talking about logistic regression, so ELI5 will try to understand that, okay, logistic regression tries to derive a linear hyperplane to separate the two classes. Then it's going to analyze the details of that logistic regression or some other model, and then it's going to provide you the explanations. So if I'm talking about LIME, so LIME is a fairly new technique. It was introduced in 2016, and this is the research paper that you can go through to get in depth. Why should I trust you is the name of the research paper. And LIME cannot be used for global explanations. It can only be used to provide local explanations. And LIME is model agnostic, meaning that whatever be your model, that doesn't really matter to LIME. It doesn't need to look at the model internally, as was the case with ELF5, and it treats everything as a black box. So a logistic regression, which is a highly interpretable model, and a neural network, which is like a complete black box, are both same for LIME. And it is important to understand, at least at a very high level, like how LIME works, and that's what we are going to discuss in the subsequent slides, because it too has some limitations, and it's not always that you can apply LIME to interpret your model and it does well. So basically, this is one of the images from the original paper, Why Should I Trust You? And LIME works this way. So if this is the red cross that's zoomed in, you're trying to provide an explanation for the same. So what LIME will do is it will randomly sample some points close to this particular observation. So it's like zooming into this particular observation. It will randomly sample some points close to that, and it will try to fit a linear model to separate that, and the interpretation of this linear model will be the overall interpretation of this particular point. So this is how LIME works on a very high level. So of course there are some drawbacks to LIME. So as I mentioned that it tries to fit a linear model locally besides the point that you're trying to explain. So let's say that your data is quite complex, your data distribution is quite complex, and the linear model is not able to generalize well. So in such a case, LIME won't be giving you good results. So as you can see that if this is a zoomed in view of that local point, and the data distribution is like this curve around that point, and you're trying to fit a linear model towards that. So as you can see, it won't generalize well, and the explanations provided in this case won't be that good. And apart from that, as I mentioned that it is based on random sampling, so it can give you inconsistent results sometimes. And one thing that I forgot to mention is that you can use LIME for tabular data, for time series, for images, and for text data. So it's pretty decent package. And another drawback is that if you're using LIME for images, this can get pretty slow. So you might want to avoid LIME in those cases. So these are some of the additional resources that you can have a look as I reference the slide. So you can look at the slides later and check these out. So it's Kaggle has a pretty nice crash course on interpretable machine learning, discussing some of the techniques beyond these slides as well. And these are some of the blog posts and the link to the original paper. And from an applied point of view, these are linked to some of the libraries that you can use for interpretable ML. And this is quite a deep subject. So this is just a fair enough introduction of the same. Of course, you can refer a lot more resources online, and this is an area of rapid research. So this is like the advancements are being made quite frequently. So there's a lot to learn. So basically, now you can open up this link. I can take a couple of minute breaks here so that you can open this, sign in with your Google account, and open the notebook in playground mode so we can just have a hands-on session with ELI5 and LIME. So if everyone is done with this, so I can open up the notebook. So you can open it in playground mode, and so let's start by running the demo. So the first two lines are pretty simple. I'm just installing LIME and ELFI libraries here using pip. So once it's done, the next step is importing the necessary libraries. I'm quite sure you all might be familiar, if you're building data science models on a daily basis, about NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib. And these are some of the scikit-learn classes that we are going to use. So column transformer is a new and was introduced in version 0.2 of scikit-learn. I will talk about later, like why do we use column transformer. Then how many of you have used pipelines before, scikit-learn pipelines? Okay, some people there. And again, these are some pretty general libraries and general packages that you might be using quite frequently. And so let me talk about the data set here. I picked up not a very complex data set. It's the breast cancer data set that comes preloaded with scikit-learn. I'm quite sure most of you might be familiar with this. And here I've just loaded that into a data frame. And if I check the head, so it's pretty simple data set. There are some 600 rows and some 21 features, and all of them are numerical, so it's a fairly easy data set. I don't think that we need much pre-processing on this data set before proceeding further. So it's a binary classification problem. We are having two classes, class 0, that is malignant cancer, and class 1, that's benignant cancer. And this is the class distribution. Like, you have benignant cancer, 357 samples, and malignant cancer, 212 samples. There are no duplicate rows, and there are no null rows. There are no null rows as well. As I told, it's a fairly simple data set. And again, this is the class distributions. This is just a bar chart for the same. And if I talk about my target variable, so the small y is denoting my target variable, and everything apart from that are my features that are stored in capital X. And as I told, that all of the fields are numerical, so I don't think we'll need one hot encoding or any other encoding to handle categorical variables, because there aren't any. So basically, what this column transformer does is, although it wasn't needed here, but if you had categorical variables, so you can create a sort of pipeline here. So what I mentioned here is, if you're having numerical features, you can do nothing, you can just pass through them. An alternative operation here would be to scale your features depending on your requirement. And apart from numerical, if you had categorical features, you can add in categorical here. And instead of this pass through, you can one-hot encode them or handle them with whatever necessary encoding you find convenient. So these are the four models which we are going to run our data set through. It's basically a logistic regression, a decision tree, a random forest, and an XGBoost. So this is from top to bottom, increasing complexity and much harder to interpret. Like, logistic regression is quite simple enough to interpret. Decision tree is a little bit harder, but it's still interpretable. Random forest can get a bit harder to interpret, and XGBoost is quite hard to interpret. So again, this is a standard procedure of splitting your data into train and test set. So it's a 70-30 split, as you can see. And basically, in the next section, we have just tried to apply logistic regression with grid search to find the optimal hyperparameters, and we have just fitted our model onto that. So we are done with all of that. We see that we got an accuracy of 94.97% on the training set. That's quite good. And the next step would be to set your parameters, your logistic regression optimized hyperparameters, to your model and train it and see how well does it do on the test set. So you can see it's a 94.73% on the test set. So it does fairly well on the test set too. So we are not overfitting here. And it's a nice precision, a nice recall, nice F1 scores. Everything is well. The only problem here is, if I am actually working at a healthcare company, and if I have to explain what my model did to a domain expert, to a healthcare expert, so how do I go about that? So the next section would be globally interpreting your model using ELF5. So I just trained my model, and now I want to interpret and explain it to a domain expert. So the API is fairly simple, as you can see. I'm just importing ELF5 here. And for global explanation, I'm doing ELF5.showweights. I'm passing in my model, and bang, I get a heat map with the model explanations. Now, one of the thing that I would like to clear is that I did not pass in a feature list to that ELF5.showweight API call. So what I'm having here is that the features are not displayed by the names. Like, you can see I'm having a weight here, and I'm having the feature as X0, X20. So this is not pretty convenient for me, and I cannot interpret something out of it. So just as a workaround, if you pass in the feature list and the feature names argument to the function, you can get in these feature names along with the weights. So basically, what's happening here is that the model, if it's giving y equals to 1, that is a benign cancer, so it's giving me the interpretations. Like, the mean radius is having the most weight, then the worst radius is another feature that's having this weight. So this way you can interpret your model. And as I mentioned, that ELF5 is looking at your model from the internally. So this is nothing but the weights of the logistic regression model. That you can get anyways, but ELF5 can be used for further enhanced models. Like, we'll see that later. So that was all about global interpretation. Now let's talk about if I want to interpret a point locally. So let's say I'm trying to interpret this particular observation. So if I have to interpret one single observation, I can just pass it here. So you can see like I'm trying to interpret the 10th observation in the test set. The original label is 1. And the API call for this would be ELF-ide or show prediction. You pass in the model here. You transform your particular data point. You provide it the feature names, and it will give you this. So for that particular data point, it's telling me that the data point belongs to a malignant cancer with a probability of 0.998. And these are the top features that are affecting the prediction the most. So the mean radius, the worst radius, and so on. You can see it like that. So you can communicate this to a domain expert and get a better view and understand better, like why your model is trying to give this much probability or why it's classifying a particular data point into one particular class. So again, this is for decision tree. So we do the same thing. We train the decision tree, got a 94% accuracy on the training set and fair enough on the test set. Although there is some difference, which might be an indicator that decision tree might be overfitting in this particular case, but again, it does fairly well. And again, as I mentioned, that ELF, I will try to understand the model internally. So basically, this is the decision tree that you're having, and that's generated again by ELF5's global interpretation. So you can visualize the decision tree, and these are just some simple if-else conditions. So you can again explain this to a domain expert and understand like what's happening here. So again, we can interpret this locally. And coming to more complex models such as a random forest. So let's say we train a random forest here. Again, good accuracy on the training set, 97%. Test set again has a 94%. Everything seems to go well. And I will come to the interpretation of random forest in XGBoost, Boost combinedly. And so before that, here's XGBoost. Again, this works fairly well. So now, as I mentioned, that ELF5 is good enough to work when you are having white box models. But if you're having a little bit complicated model such as random forest and XGBoost, so LIME is going to be your choice of package. And as I also mentioned earlier, that you can use LIME for tabular data, for image data, and for time series and text data as well. So the way it works is you need to create an explainer for the same. I'm having tabular data, so I'm importing the LIME tabular explainer. You can have live image explainer and subsequent classes for the type of interpretation you want to do. So basically, you want to convert your data first to the LIME format, the format that LIME expects it to be. So basically, it should not be one-hot encoded. And here we are not having any categorical variables, so that is something we need not worry about. And basically, you need to pass in your data as a data frame. So this X here is a NumPy array. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to convert that into a data frame. So once we are into that, we have converted our data to the LIME format using the function that I told above. And you define an explainer object here. You pass in all the things, you pass in all your values. You pass it the mode, like whether you are doing classification or regression. Here we are doing classification. You pass it the feature names, and you pass it a random state. And the next step would be to interpret one local observation. So as I said, that LIME works for local interpretation. So we can interpret a particular data point. So if I'm trying to interpret the second observation in the test set, these are the results. The original label here was class label 1, and these are the probabilities that various models gave it. So logistic regression gives it a 99.8% probability, and subsequent probabilities are listed here. So if I want to interpret this using LIME, all I want to do here is just create an explainer object. And basically, if I want to see the results in a Jupyter notebook, you would say explanation.show in notebooks, show label is true. And once I have that, so basically LIME will tell me like these are the top 5 features or top K features that you can specify here that are trying to explain why your model is taking a particular decision. So here, if I have to talk like why my model is giving class 1, so you can see that the worst area feature is having a lot of importance towards determining class 1. Similarly, if I have to talk about class 0, the worst radius is having this much impact. So basically, you can have a look at through this to LIME. And yeah, there are a couple of more examples. If I want to predict XGBoost, above you can see I'm trying to interpret a random forest. So basically it's model agnostic and you can use any type of model to interpret through line. And basically, as I said, that it's using a linear model when we are fitting to that particular local data point. So if you want to know how well that linear model is fitting the data, basically you can check out the R squared value of that particular linear model, and the explanation.score is basically giving you the R squared value of the same. So here we can see that in this particular scenario, the R squared value that the linear model is giving is 0.21. That's not that great, and that's one of the drawbacks that I mentioned, that it depends on how well your linear model is fitting the data in that particular local region. So basically that depends on that. So coming to the conclusion, like, why do you need interpretability? So machine learning is growing pretty fast, and therefore it's pretty necessary for us as data scientists to explain our prediction to make machine learning transparent to everyone. And interpretable ML, as I mentioned, is a field of rapid research, and the advancements are happening quite frequently, so there's a lot to learn. And apart from that, you should add interpretation to a data science lifecycle as an extra step to increase the fairness of your model. And being able to interpret and explain your prediction gives you an edge over other data scientists and definitely makes you a better data scientist. And companies definitely need data scientists who can explain their model's decision so that they can explain it to their client or the stakeholders. And some industries are extremely sensitive. As I mentioned, healthcare, where a model with very good performance would be useless if you cannot explain it to your client or your stakeholders. So that's all from my side. Thank you so much for listening. And if there are any questions, so please feel free.